is a few years there because he says it's only four other Junes since 1982. So this doesn't go all the way back to like 1950 where we have some of the ENSO data. But he's mentioning there a few different other Junes that, let's see there. So it had weekly Nino values this warm. It was 1983, 87, 97, and 2015. So 2015 was actually the last time we had a strong El Nino during hurricane season. There was one 2018-19, but as we were discussing kind of before this started, that one was kind of weak.
Right, and it didn't play in massively, but what's so interesting looking at kind of the overall scenario, and I mean, you can just clearly tell, it's almost wild how there's just that line of warmer temperatures right there at the equatorial Pacific. And, you know, the one thing that all of the meteorological academia folks are discussing is you've got El Nino, which typically suppresses tropical activity. But Jeremy, the issue here is we've got such warm sea surface temperatures in the Atlantic basin. It's kind of like this squeeze play of which one takes the cake in terms of the overall influencer.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know those years that he referenced what the Atlantic waters look like, but we know this year they're definitely running above average. So if you start to get any type of low pressure trough in there, it may have a little more accelerated development. So it's kind of two factors, see which one wins out.
Well, and one thing that's interesting is, you know, in looking at El Niños, and of course, give me 2 seconds to dial this in here, but in looking at El Niño, type the word Nino. Okay, sorry. Running the computer, Jeremy, you know, it's... But
and
you know,
talking, that's a task.
You do it all the time, you know. But when you get that El Nino pattern in the Pacific, warmer water means warmer air, means it's rising. What we end up usually seeing is this kind of shearing effect in the Atlantic. And there are definitely waves of shear, but the question is going to be, where is that shear in relation to moisture combining with sea surface temperatures, combining with Saharan dust? All of these things are playing in, and it's like, which one is going to end up overall impacting versus just kind of playing second fiddle, so to speak?
Yeah, and also this is just developed, so we're not at the level. I was taking a look back, I would say, 2015, when we were in the heart of hurricane season, that was a strong El Nino. So we probably had some of those stronger upper level winds that you see on the map there that can kind of reduce activity, be a little less favorable once you might try to get a disturbance to form. That shear, not favorable for tropical development, but it's not necessarily the whole basin has this crazy shear. So we kind of have to watch where these storms want to form. And also, a little bit farther north into the Atlantic, we have water temperatures that are running above average as well.
And you know, it's not even just above average. And I see people are commenting. We will be getting to your comments and questions in a couple of minutes. But it's not just above average, Jeremy. We're actually kind of in uncharted territory when it comes to the ocean temperatures. We've never been this hot in this kind of point of hurricane season.
Yeah, and I believe the map you're showing there, just so people know, the bluer colors, that might be at the moment a little bit below average. Mm-hmm. And then the red across much of the central part of the Atlantic there, into the Caribbean, parts of the Gulf, that's running above average. Right. And even those blues, that's just at least a little bit below average.
But when we look at the temperatures, I mean, so this is the actual water temperature map. And like, let's just look those areas that were maybe below average. I mean, we're still talking about, you know, 70s. It's not like it's chilly. Well, you know, you get off the coast of like Jersey and it's 61 there. But like the Gulf Stream waters off of the shoreline of your coastline, Jeremy, the Gulf Stream's at 82. The Gulf Stream in my area is 83. The loop current in the Gulf of Mexico is already showing 85 to 86 degree water temperature. So these areas are already in sufficient territory for tropical development.
Yeah, now we just need to see if any of these disturbances track over that area. Our forecast, especially maybe more northern western Gulf that we put out, was not quite in a hot spot this year. It was more closer you get to Florida, southeast, parts of the southeast coast, and then up around the Carolinas. So those were kind of areas we were watching. Then we also thought the Atlantic could be very busy, maybe even off the east coast. Yeah. It seemed to be kind of a parade of low pressure areas that were running up there. So it's interesting you mentioned the water temperature there off from the northeast coast, because we are coming up in a part of the pattern where there might be a little area of low pressure that wants to head up in that direction. But again, back in January, it was an unnamed storm. And I guarantee in January, the water temperatures were not that warm.
Right. I mean, right near the shoreline, the water temperatures are in the 60s, you know, but you get just a little off the shoreline, it's 70, 72. That's not really sufficient for tropical development, subtropical right. perhaps. But yeah, as you mentioned, should I pop up the long range calendar, Jeremy, while we're discussing this?
Sure.
All right. So for anybody that follows me on Twitter, I tweeted one out, but there was a miscommunication between Jeremy and I. So I had the dates yesterday that were a little off. My apologies.
Yeah, I mean, we're coming up here where there could be a little area of low pressure off from anywhere from North Carolina to New England. It should be off the coast. It might even move from land and then head out over the waters. But that would be coming up here. Maybe like 16th to 21st, somewhere in that time frame.
Just, and we can look at the models too here in a couple seconds.
Yeah, just something to watch. And then obviously the GFS, sort of never-ending fantasy storms once you get out past about 200 to 240 hours. That did back off that, and we were thinking it probably would, or it would it be a weaker version. It still has some sort of a random tropical development, maybe, because it's not very consistent now right. with the placement of it. But I think if something were to form, maybe Western Caribbean or closer to the Yucatan, maybe. But right. Again, confidence in that is pretty low.
And this time of year, we always watch the CAG. We call them CAG lows, the Central American gyres. These kind of little spin-ups that happen from moisture. So it does make sense to watch kind of that Western Caribbean into the southern Gulf of Mexico, the Bay of Campeche there. That part of the pattern is favored looking ahead to next week. So we'll have to watch and see if, and I would be, you know, I'd be willing to put down $20 right now, and I'm cheap, so that says something, that we're not going to get a monster storm down there, Jeremy, but a right. little area of moisture that may take a little bit of, spin to it or something to that effect.
Yeah, and not what, I mean, like you showed just a great stat last time. I mean, things can happen that are out of the ordinary, but you were showing there's been two major hurricanes ever in the month of June from right. Some of the numbers you looked at.
Right.
So what the GFS was continually trying to spin up in the longer range just did not seem feasible. And we're not to that point yet. We haven't quite reached where it was trying to put that. But I don't know. That to me just seems unlikely. And again, yeah. we're really focused on just a handful of locations for right. the rest of this month. Once we get into July, though, we think definitely could have some more of those areas of interest start to pop up and need to pay a little closer attention.
Well, and you'd mentioned it. So, you know, we jump right into July in that first week. We've got kind of this feature watching the Carolina coast there. Each recycle over the wintertime has at least seen some sort of a storm system there. But, you know, the rest of this month, June is going to be fairly quiet for us, your area, my area. But going right into July, that first week is kind of watching that eastern seaboard. And then the second week of, you know, the 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, that's where the Gulf of Mexico and the Florida Gulf Coast have to start watching. So we're getting back into that recycle of activity, and combine that with these warm water temperatures. The only question is, where will that wind shear be in that moment of time? It's a little too far out to track, of course, but these are the hot spots that we're watching. And even if it's, you know, even if it's a weak little piece of energy, it's still something that's going to be in those areas.
Yeah, and really, it's almost that first 2 weeks of July that it's kind of like southeastern coast, Carolinas, because you have multiple areas of low pressure. We had one low pressure area at the front end of the last window that went into the Carolinas yeah. that was, I don't even think it was an area of interest. And then obviously we had that system Memorial Day weekend, yep. which we still debate a little bit. Maybe that could have been subtropical, but either way, That was a very impressive storm system.
Yep.
So we have multiple lows really that first couple of weeks of July, and we'll see what happens. Again, you have to keep in mind though, May, June, July, those are some of the quietest months of hurricane season. Throw in November with that. Really, it's you get to August, September, October, and you typically have more development.
Right. So and a great way to visualize that is by looking at the month of June, and this graphic just kind of illustrates where systems have formed during the month of June. And overwhelmingly, just like May, overwhelmingly, it's all fairly close. You've got all these kind of Western Caribbean spots into the Gulf, areas right along the eastern seaboard. Every now and then, we've had a couple little pieces of energy off the coast of Africa or into the kind of what we refer to as the MDR, the main development region. But with all of these systems clustered very close to land, remember, it's just hard to get things to explode fast and get that development to really get going. So June systems, that's why when you look at the stats, that's why these June systems are typically much weaker. But notice for the southeastern United States coastline, many of those paths have crossed your coverage area and my coverage area. But 6% of all storms form during the month of June.
Yeah, it's generally a pretty quiet month. I wouldn't want to see a real busy month of June. Might be a little precursor to things later on. But yeah, we have a lot of variables in play this year with now officially El Nino. We kind of know when the bulk of the activity should be through probably that very early part of October, what kind of portions of hurricane season to really watch out for.
Right.
And then you might get a little something along the way, especially if we start seeing those disturbances come off the west coast of Africa. Something, at least I haven't really heard much about it this year, is any type of excess like dust. The last couple of years, I feel like we've had a lot of Saharan dust, but so far, I haven't really heard much about that.
Yeah, so that's the wide shot there of the Atlantic, all right? And so for now, there's not much doing. But let me look up the Saharan dust here for you. There is some. I was just looking at this before I hopped on to the broadcast with you, Jeremy. And very clearly, you can see. Now, for those that are not familiar, what we're looking at is the entire Atlantic, right? And those orange shades, that's the aerosols coming off of the Saharan Desert there. And so certainly the main development region has plenty of that Saharan dust. But this is not the time of year where we watch for that kind of tropical activity. But all these waves that are rolling off the coast of Africa are dealing with this dust, which is among other reasons why we're not getting much development there. But you come over here toward the Caribbean, you come over toward the Gulf of Mexico, and that's not the case. There's really not much Saharan dust out here. Little particles here or there, but these are going to be the areas to watch because that dust has not moved out this direction, at least not yet this season.
Right. So I think lately, all of our attention when it comes to like dust particulates or smoke or anything has all been wildfire driven. We had a little bit of that make its way down into the southeast. But
right.
Yeah, so far, Saharan dust hasn't really stolen any headlines. So we'll see if that continues most of the season. Should we take a look at some of the models right now? Not a ton to.
Yeah.
To look at here.
Yep. All right. So here's a look. This is the American GFS, and it's always fun to start with this because this is the one that always likes to just go bonkers. And I've zoomed it in to at least, you know, the Gulf Caribbean section because that's where this time of year you would probably see activity trying to get forming early. So there's that. And for those of you that are not familiar, this is the model that looks at. I don't know, Jeremy. I like looking at this one because it's kind of like an X-ray. It throws up flags much quicker. It looks at anomalously high or anomalously lower pressures. Makes sense?
Yep.
So in this case, the greens that you're looking at and the blues, that's just slightly lowered pressure over normal. Okay. Nothing crazy. But, you know, looking at, you know what? Let's just go to the whole basin. Let's do that. So just rolling through. And the first thing you notice is there's the 15th of June. And Jeremy, there's a nice little complex of storms rolling off the northeastern United States. That to me is probably going to be that northeastern United States low we were discussing.
Right. It's on at least a couple different models. And as I mentioned, it might be something that's exiting land, heading out over the water. Will it be tropical, subtropical? I don't know if it'll have enough time or what it'll look like. out there. But yeah, that is that part of the pattern. We'll just keep an eye on it.
Yep.
Doesn't look super impressive. Some models try to get it a little bit stronger, but at least it should be moving away from the coast.
Yeah. All right. So continuing on, nothing crazy. Big Bermuda High. That's the orange shade there in the center of the map. And then right there around Central America, it's going to be the bottom left corner of the map there. Here, I'll move it into the Caribbean just to show. It's at the very, very bottom of your screen there. We're starting to see like purple shades kind of around Central America. That's the model trying to develop that CAG low. This is 246 hours out, so it's way down the pike. That's the 23rd. Again, the GFS has consistently been showing something, but you have to understand that that's the bias of this model. It's seeing these little CAG lows, and it's trying to throw extra spin and vorticity. This is what the GFS does. You kind of just have to throw it out, Jeremy.
Yeah, especially once you get past probably 200 to 240 hours, because it just starts kind of throwing some stuff out there. And then, as we mentioned, it never really wants to follow through as the model's getting closer and closer. Right. It seems like last week at this time we were showing almost similar things.
And at the same time frame, it keeps kicking the can down the road just a little bit. So that's the GFS. Yep. Let's come over and let's look at the European.
I think of any model, the European has probably been about the quietest here recently.
Yeah. So this is the European. This is the 6E. It only goes out 144 hours. Let's go to the full Atlantic Basin. There's that kind of northeastern United States storm system kind of doing something, you know, nothing of note, but it's doing something. If we go back to the 0Z, which is the last full run, you know, it's not really showing much of anything. Just lower areas of pressure, but nothing all that organized. But, you know, one thing to note, if we look at the GFS ensembles, and everybody talks about these little CAG lows and you know, the GFS, it's trying to go crazy with development. But if you look at the ensemble, and this is, think of this as the GFS run 30 different ways, or actually 51 different
ways.
That
sounds like a nightmare.
Yeah, but it's only showing like four different ensembles trying to develop something like that. So when you're talking 50 different versions of the GFS and four are trying to develop something in the Gulf at all, you know, you're not really talking about much in the way of ensemble support. So
now,
that's
show off like the Northeast coast, because I would guess that it's showing many more possibilities of a low there.
There. Yeah. I mean, right there. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, that's the 17th. And if we just looked at our time frame, the 17th of June is that watching offshore Northeast United States. There's a bunch of ensembles kind of showing that in that time frame. Yeah. And then there's more ensemble support there. All those little L's that you're looking at.
Yep. So that's kind of why that was something we've been highlighting. And then a little bit farther down the road, we'll see maybe if something is in the Western Caribbean. I even think that there could be a little low and then it hops over Central America. Yeah. This time of year heads into the Pacific.
That wouldn't surprise me at all. I mean, you know, when you look at this is a graphic that, you know, kind of came up with this year, and I kind of love it because it's, in addition to just showing the normal spots, this actually shows like where have Atlantic systems formed. And you know, one of the things of note, this little guy right in there started in the Pacific and crossed, you know, over Central America. And the same thing could happen where it'll cross out toward the Pacific. So this time of year, we love that Central American area, those CAG lows that love to kind of spin stuff up.
Yep. Also a question, and I don't know if I'm putting you on the spot. Did you update the ACE numbers? I know you're really good with that. I thought I saw that pop up earlier.
You know,
we're still kind of just hanging out where we were a week ago, and ACE scores don't really jump up a whole lot. And you can tell people a little more about what that is.
Yeah. So ACE, think of this as a scorecard. Okay. So the bigger a tropical system is, the longer the tropical system exists, that ticks up these numbers little bit by little bit by little bit. So in terms of this year, we've generated 2.6 ACE points through today. And this is a non-weighted score. So the good news is if you get a Category 6 hurricane, that doesn't exist, but you get the point. If you get a Category 5 hurricane, that's a big storm, and it lasts in the Atlantic way out in the middle of nowhere for a week, it's generating a ton of ACE points. If you get a little tropical storm for a week, it's generating much less ace points. So this is the accumulated cyclonic energy. So 2.6 is our current number. The 30-year average through today is 1.5. So we've had more activity than normal. And if you look at through last year through today, we had generated 1.6 ace points. When you look at the named storm numbers, Jeremy, it's the kind of same thing. We've had two named systems. We had that no name in January and we had Arlene. The normal for today, 30-year average, is 0.8 storms, and last year we had one. So we're still definitely running above average in those metrics, but it's still obviously very early in the season.
Yeah, and those numbers really, I mean, they just accelerate quickly once you get into like August, September, early October. So if you're still slow with development come August, September, you're going to fall below average really fast because that metric goes up quick. But I mean, as of now, we're at two storms for the year. Will we see another one before the end of June? Maybe. I would say absolute max would be two.
Yeah.
Maybe one, but definitely could be zero as well.
I would think that that the number stays relatively low because these features were not hotspots. These were not the main players. But getting into those first few weeks of July, those are much bigger players in our long-range forecast. Right. So I do think that July does become a more, you know, climatologically, it normally does get a bit more active. But I definitely think, while we're going to be subdued here these next few weeks, getting into July, things are going to get kicking.
Yeah, and if by chance we get through July and maybe there's only one named storm in July, doesn't mean hurricane season's over. But to us, then we might be like, maybe this would be a slower season. But the opposite could be where all of a sudden, what if we have three or so named storms already up to maybe like five, potentially six named storms, and then you're almost halfway to average.
Well, and you know, if there's one thing Phil Klotzbach is very clear about, he always says things like, there's nothing more humbling than doing a long-range forecast, or long-range forecasting is hard. And we're in the game of that. He's in the game of that. Nobody will ever say that it's easy. Nobody will ever say that they're going to be perfect. We try. That's our job. But Mother Nature, there's so many, you know, these mathematical equations we call computer models are great, but they're not perfect. And there's so many variables we just don't have the brain power or computing power to cycle through yet.
Yeah. And if you have our hotspot map, maybe let's just show everyone that. Yep. I would say when we put our seasonal forecast out March 1st every single year, our confidence is probably highest in the hotspots. And then second is obviously our forecast for the season. But I really feel like each and every year going in, we're pretty confident that the hotspots are really the areas to watch.
100%. 100%. Which means Florida again and the Carolinas again. And when it comes to the numbers, you know, I don't know that I did update this. Okay. All right. So NOAA's numbers, our numbers, and Colorado State's updated numbers. So we're all, you know, we're all fairly close. NOAA's range is monstrous. You know, Colorado State tries to pick numbers and we kind of try to go with a much smaller range than NOAA. But I think our idea is at or slightly above average. Colorado State is saying kind of the same thing. And NOAA's like, it's going to hurricane season's going to hurricane season.
Last year, though, NOAA was 14 to 21. So they have trimmed that range down a bit.
That's good. So it's going to hurricane season. It's going to either be a little slightly below or a little slightly above.
Yeah. Again, seasonal forecasting is tricky. I think everyone will say that. But I mean, we accept it as a challenge each and every year because one thing we don't like to do is lose.
Right. Right. Which is why we go, you know, our job is to tell you the forecast every day. But we go, I don't want to say we go above and beyond, but like we want to make sure that we're constantly studying the weather, that we're constantly learning how to do it better. And that means doing long range forecasting and doing these little town hall discussions because your questions, which we'll be getting to shortly, help us understand what you want to know so that we can better do our jobs. So by putting all of this together, I think that it really I always tell everybody, Jeremy, it helps me as much as I hope it helps them, because we're giving them weather information, but they're giving us the questions that they want asked.
Right. All right. So speaking of questions, we can get to a couple here before we wrap things up.
Yeah, absolutely. All right.
So
it's open. Questions on all of the social channels, please go ahead. Mickey is asking, is the MJO coming into phase soon? That's a great question, Mickey. Jeremy, I've seen some rumblings that we're kind of trying to get there in that July time stretch.
Yeah, I think that obviously the method we use and the MJO have a relation with each other. So it's not something I look at every single day because again, I look at, like, Eric and I, he's big on ensembles. I look at different models. Like, sometimes I'll be like, hey, did you look at the Canadian model? He's like, no. So we look at different things. Personally, I'm not, like, every single day looking at MJO or what phase it's in. Eric may do that. I kind of have, it's almost like you go fishing. You know what lures or what bait works for you. Yep. So when it comes to the tool chest for forecasting, there's some things I usually go to. Eric has his. And I would not say that every single day I'm looking at the MJO because sort of the method we use is maybe a little bit tied to that, but more we are translating that down to more sensible weather and more specific detail.
Well, and, you know, I also want to add that I have always found in working with multiple meteorologists, everybody doing their own thing really just helps out the greater good. And I think that that's what is so beautiful, Jeremy, is the fact that you do look at some different things than I look at, and we can compare notes and put that together. And I think that that plays into our hurricane forecast in a beautiful way, both in the longer term and in the shorter term, because sure, I'm looking at the ensembles and you're looking at the Canadian, and we're kind of comparing notes, because at the end of the day, we're both husbands. We both work full time. We both have families. And so by pooling our resources, we can have a better grasp of everything to work together and use a venue like this to try and share that kind of information.
Yeah, like I'm at home right now. Sometimes you're at WESH working, but yeah, like right before we started here, I was like out there telling my kids, I was like, hey, try to quiet down. They just got back from swim practice. I know like right now you said your wife teaches, so she's at home. So you have people at home right now. Today you're at home. Other times you're at work. So we're busy, but we're always, trying to kind of at least, have one eye on the forecast and keep everyone updated.
Oh, 100%. So Bo's asking, is the GFS wanting the storm part of the Ian part of the pattern? It looks like the same path as Ian. Bo, the one thing to remember, Ian was last year's cycle. So that's done and over with. And when we look at our hotspots for the year, the southwest part of Florida is actually not, I would help if I did this button. Hold on. I'm directing and talking, my bad. But the Ian, you know, the Ian part is done. So southwest Florida is not really a hotspot of ours this year. It's more like Sarasota up through the panhandle, and then on the east coast, that's the Nicole part of the pattern, and then up by Jeremy, you've got that Carolina series of lows that kept wanting to do their thing.
Yeah, and I would say, I mean, so if you're not in a hot spot like say southwest Florida, doesn't mean you're not, don't have to watch things. Or Arlene, I mean, that kind of scooted its way down
right
towards Cuba, swung around, and then headed back out towards the Bahamas. So just because you're not in a hot spot, still need to watch it. But again, our hot spots are just, to us, areas with a much higher than average chance of seeing something landfall.
Right. And these were the areas like that first cycle that we had tracked. And just because over time, most of them did not go anywhere near southwest Florida, that doesn't mean that you're completely out of the game. It just means that maybe you've got a more average opportunity to see landfall. The hotspots are just showing areas that have an above average chance of landfall. So, what other questions does anybody have? Let's see here. Just my luck. I live in North Carolina, Mike says, and there will be something to happen the week I go on vacation in July.
Well, I mean, maybe it's just a rainy low or something like that. But I would say if you're falling in that window we highlighted, I would just not cancel your trip at all, but just, hey, keep an eye on it.
Yeah, yeah. And then again, you know, so July 2nd through the 10th is going to be that Carolina area. And then again, and perhaps more threatening would be that August 21st through that August 29th timeline there.
Yeah. Yeah. Anytime we get into August, September, first half of October, that's when these systems would potentially be a little more prone to be stronger, I guess.
Right. Right. And then, you know, obviously water temperatures are higher, but then again, like the question arises, it's like we're getting into, you know, theoretically El Nino would be kicking in more, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So how does that all play out?
Right. Yeah. I mean, it'll be, this is a good season to, one, see how it plays out and then learn from that.
Yeah.
For future seasons.
It'll definitely be a case study year. William is asking, will Dunellen, Florida, get a hurricane this year? You know, we can't forecast that deep, but, you know, there are two parts of the overall cycling pattern that do focus on our area here in Central Florida. The West Coast storm system, July 11th through the 16th, and then again, August 30th through September 5th. That was a Gulf low that has kind of cycled through and through and through. And then the Nicole part of the pattern, we know what happened November of last year. As that recycles over and over again, we're watching July 19th through the 25th when I'm out of town. So that'll be... And then hopefully nothing there. And then September 8th through the 14th is kind of that next recycle. So we'll have to see how it plays out, which even though I'm out of town, Jeremy, we'll still be doing this. And I believe you may be out of town at some point. We'll have to do this via distance as well.
I might be tied up next Tuesday around 10 a.m. So we'll adjust the time. Last week it was on Wednesday. And then obviously we threw that little quick update in when we had Arlene forming. So we're flexible. And, but one thing is certain, we'll keep everyone updated.
Yeah. 100%. All right. Any other closing thoughts, my friend, before we wrap it up today?
No, I mean, coming up here, let's just see if we get that low off the Northeast coast and then, sort out what happens, maybe Western Caribbean, if there's anything. And, then July, not too far away.
Yeah, and July's when it gets busy. All right, very good. Hey, thank you, everybody, for joining us today. We're doing it every week, and I love it. And as Jeremy mentioned, when there's actual stuff to track, if there's threats, we're going to be here a lot. So, yeah, good times. All right, listen, I'm WESH2 meteorologist Eric Burris.
I'm WJCL 22, chief meteorologist Jeremy Nelson.
Thank you so much for talking and hanging out with us. We'll see you later.
All right, have a good day.